It's a busy day, and this morning the CFTC, the Commodity Futures Trading Commission, made some big headlines when it said that it was fining stablecoin issuer Tether for over $42 million. The essential claim here is that the USDT stablecoin, of which there are $69 billion worth of circulation currently, was not being fully backed at all times. This is a fine, maybe not a big fine in the grand scheme of things, but it's certainly a notable action against a very prominent player within the crypto space. So I'm going to throw this to Will for his initial thoughts, and then we will get this thing going. Will, what do you think about the CFTC action against Tether?
This goes back to a conversation we had, I think, earlier this week or last week, talking about potential movement against Celsius, and that's why they raised a bunch of funds. And I was thinking, what if Celsius gets slapped with a fine? Like, what's the worst thing that happens to them? Like, they lose $30 million, $50 million. They keep doing business as usual. See, that's what happened here with Tether. They get slapped with a fine. This is one of the oldest stories in crypto. Is Tether backed? Is it not backed? People have gone around the circus just for ages, made a career out of it, and kind of ends here, right? With just this Tether case right here, $42.5 million, get slapped with a fine, keep doing business as usual. It's interesting also to look at Tether's statement afterwards. They said, this inquiry arose during a markedly different time in our ecosystem and focused on the same types of challenges that many in our industry faced at that time. As many companies around the world do, Tether agreed to resolve the matter in order to move forward and focus on the future. So I think it's just that, like, now it's done. Now that FUD is done, they've finished up with the CFTC. And if we can kind of get the story along, moving to the next topic. Naomi, I'll throw it down to you, though.
Yeah, this is kind of an interesting story because it's very rare for me to say this, but it's kind of an area where you do want some sort of recourse or protection against companies if they are fraudulently putting on their website that something is, you know, A, and then it ends up being B. Then you need some recourse as a consumer. You know, obviously, I have my ideas about how in an ideal society that would be managed. But in this instance, we have the Commodities Future Trading Commission kind of pushing back and charging them. And I mean, if they're fraudulently representing what their product is, it's not that at all. If they're saying that this is fully backed and it actually wasn't, well, it seems legitimate that consumers would want some recourse in that. Now, none of this is going to consumers. There's just a bunch of money that keeps going to these agencies. But it is interesting that that these findings are now, you know, they're pushed back against Tether and Bitfinex, and now everything's kind of been wound up on this side. They've changed their language since then. They've made it a lot less strong, where they've said, "Yeah, we're backing it by some things." There's a bunch of stuff there. And it's like, okay, so it's like, you know, we've got a bunch of debt instruments or whatever. And that's the way that most stable coins are backed these days. But at least that's accurately represented. And now consumers can make a well-informed decision about whether this is a product that they want to get involved with. But I'll throw it to you, Jen, for your thoughts.
You kind of answered my question. You're like one step ahead of me today. I was going to say, so Tether has been fined now. The CFTC says one thing. Tether's gone back and said another thing, pretty much opposites. Like, it is fully backed. It's not fully backed. They've been fined. But now what happens? They just change their messaging and continue on as normal. Is there no further recourse?
Well, there shouldn't be any further recourse. I mean, there's no reason punitive because... Well, as long as consumers know what they're getting, that is that transparency that's important. So they were fined as sort of retribution for lying on the website, for fraudulent representation of their product, and now they can move on as long as they're not still fraudulently representing it. There's no reason why they can't accurately represent it, and then consumers still get involved with this.
Yeah, I think that, you know, the big picture for me here is it's easy to claim transparency and not do anything about it. And I think for a long time that had been the case here. And I think to your point, Naomi, you're right. There needs to be some accountability for that. That's what these technologies, these blockchain technologies represent, is sort of transparency and accountability in code. But that wasn't the case here with a private company operating at a remove from some of these blockchain systems. So for them to sort of be brought into line, could be one way to look at it, you know, ready to look to the future is how they're sort of spinning this. It's going to be interesting to see if this allays any of the doubts of many people in the market who really do wonder if this is a systemic risk to this becoming a bigger part of the world's financial system. So interesting to see this settlement for sure. But Naomi, I saw your hand go up. I want to throw it back to you.
Yeah, like these centralized stablecoins are really interesting because there is an element of trust that is needed at the point of issue for all of them. It's not just Tether. It's any one of these companies that's issuing these stablecoins. The reason being is that they're not minting one of these coins in a transparent way every time someone puts money into, you know, into Tether. They're not, like, people don't send them US dollars and then they mint a coin and send it. The transaction fees would be astronomical. They mint them all in advance so they have a liquidity pool that's available so that people can buy in. And you kind of got to trust, like, you know, that they're minting the right amount, like that the money's going in, and who can audit the amount of money going in? Well, you got to know which bank accounts it's going into. And well, this stuff isn't public because that'd be a major security risk. And so then they have third party auditors come in and say, yeah, we saw the amount of money going in. This is all above board. But there's a real big element of trust there with all of them to actually say, yes, the amount of money going in is the amount that we are printing, which has been the contentious issue all along. And it's why a lot of people prefer decentralized stablecoins like MakerDAO, DAI. You know, the fact that it's all completely transparent, auditable on the blockchain, that is such an improvement over these opaque centralized systems. And it's why people are so excited about DeFi. And it's why people are saying, you know, we don't need regulation in this side of things because the code does it all for you. Consumers can literally see transparently what money is going in and what money is going out. Regulation on the other side kind of makes sense if you have an opaque centralized system. But when all of this stuff is out in the open and there's no central company who could be hiding anything behind the scenes, that regulation doesn't really make much sense. So the fact that you have Gensler coming along and saying, well, we're going to shoehorn these DeFi systems into our regulatory model, it's like, to what end? Why do we need it? You know, it just seems like a power grab more than anything. But Zach, I saw your hand go up. I'll throw it to you.
Yeah, I'm really glad you brought up DAI. There was a really fantastic piece by Andrew Thurman on Coindesk.com yesterday about DeFi's top unofficial lobbyist. And this is he operates under a pseudonym and he meets with various lawmakers and officials around the world, actually. And one of the interesting nuggets in that story actually was that in terms of sort of crypto awareness among US lawmakers, it really is Bitcoin and Tether. Those are the two crypto assets that people are familiar with. And part of this guy's job as sort of this DeFi delegate in the halls of power is sort of being able to explain the differences between a stablecoin like DAI and a stablecoin like USDC or USDT and why those are different animals altogether. But it speaks to the awareness, I thought, of the public perception of Tether as being this sort of dicey thing that no one is quite all the way sure about. And people keep discovering the same things over and over as they enter this space and talk about some of these same lingering questions. So if this settlement is able to allay some of those doubts or answer some of those lingering questions, it may be a good thing for the industry going forward. Whether or not we'll see a full telling of what occurred in the past, I think that ship may have sailed. But it's interesting to see action against Tether take place in a pretty pronounced fashion here today.